Hello and welcome to LNG Watch. I'm Desmond Wong. Now, going ahead into this winter, the question on everyone's minds is exactly where is the price going to go as the temperatures begin to drop? To help us answer these questions is Javier Diaz and Stephanie Wilson. So Javier, exactly what's been the situation with volatility leading up to this winter?
We can see in this chart the evolution of short-term imports compared to long-term imports and prices. As we can see here, since Fukushima, we have seen an increase in market tightness that has led to a support of JKM prices over long-term prices over longer periods of times during the winter seasons.
Ah, well, with that in mind, exactly what's been affecting, because I noticed we have a long downward stretch for the JKM this summer, and what's been leading up to that, Steph?
Well, this year has actually been super interesting. Normally what you would see in Asia is a summer spike as you get more air conditioning demand from Southeast Asia and Northeast Asia. This year, there was no summer price spike. In fact, we actually reached three-year lows and the JKM bottomed out at $10.52 for September delivery. Since then, it has rebounded. It's gaining some ground again, around 30% or more than 30% of its value. Now it's managed to claw back. But if we look at what's actually supporting the increase, there's not that much fundamental behind it. It's predominantly driven by sentiment based on the contango leading up to the winter. If you look at the inventory levels within Asia, which is partly the reason the prices came down so hard in the first instance, they're still pretty high. Korea is out of the market, the world's single biggest buyer of LNG. KOGAS is not expected to come back for the winter for spot cargoes. Japanese buyers still have very strong inventory in tank. And because of all the downward quantity tolerance that's been exercised across term contracts in Asia because of the lower than expected demand, largely due to lower temperatures over summer and what looks to be a fairly moderate winter so far in terms of temperature, you've actually got a lot of spare capacity within the Asia-Pacific basin, which has driven the prices down. Factor into that what we call the Papua New Guinea effect, new production in that country, which has added some 22 cargoes to the market, all loose available for spot for the main part. And we have seen one of the sharpest declines in JKM that we've had for a long time. Obviously, the question is, we didn't have a summer spike. Will we have a winter spike? Is there enough this year to actually drive the price back to where we would expect for the winter?
Well, it seems like inventories are also pretty high out here in Europe as well. So at the moment, at least, there seems to be a lot of volume going around. So things look quite uncertain for winter this year. But going beyond winter, the long-term outlook seems to be less bearish, I suppose. Could you tell us a little more about that, Javier?
Yes, we expect the market tightness to continue being there for the rest of the decade. We expect the size of the global market to increase by about 20 BCF by 2020, with the Asian region remaining the premium market globally, accounting for about 75% of the global market. One of the reasons for that is global regasification capacity exceeding liquefaction additions at least by until 2016. When upcoming export capacity from U.S. projects will help to bridge that gap.
I guess while things are uncertain in the short term, demand certainly looks to continue to be firm going ahead in the coming years. And, thanks for joining us, Javier, Steph, and that's it from us at LNG Watch. Please join us again next time.